altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
We welcome you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to St. Paul Presbyterian Church. We are so glad that you are here this Sunday morning. Friends, we invite you to take time as we, this past week, Ash Wednesday, marks the beginning of Lent. We encourage you to look for ways to receive nurture and support. Lent is a time in which we take special time to reflect upon our relationship with Christ. As disciples, it's a time where we ponder the incredible gift that Christ has given as we remember the weeks before, the days before of Christ preparing for the cross with his beloved disciples. There is opportunity to be able to midweek as well as on Sunday morning enter into the season of meditation, reflection, and recommitment as a disciple of Christ. We are thankful for the ways that each of us here have been a part of service and mission. There was the CCSC this past Saturday. I don't know if there's an update. Anybody would like to share about our service this past, just yesterday, in regards to being a part of once a month mission locally. It's very needed, as you know, as we're coming out of the pandemic, or we are in the midst of learning to be in this new stage in which some of us will be wearing masks, some of us won't. Some of us have opportunity where we are comfortable and well to engage and be a part of more service. Coming up in April, there's a special drive for our emphasis for mission. You're going to hear about that for CCSC, as well as the Church Under the Bridge, and then our regular opportunities to be nurtured. We have Christian Women's Fellowship on Mondays, and many of you are part of that. We have our Presbyterian Women's Circle midweek. Our members are a part of that. We invite you to also consider the Lenten study that will be offered in 2 weeks. eBlast will have information. We are determining if that will be virtual or in person at Mary Bates. But we invite you to join that study. It will be by Walter Brueggemann, professor of Old Testament, having an emphasis upon peace, justice, and truth. How we live that out during Lent. Ponder the ways we need to recommit and to broaden the church's witness towards the ways we proclaim our lives in Christ. New life and a life of mercy, of justice, and truth. Friends, please take note as that goes out in eBlast this week, and there are their announcements. Ms. Sharon. Also, if there are any of those that are visiting, we want to recognize you this morning. If you're comfortable standing, that we can welcome and then have conversation with you after the service, make sure you have support. We're going to try to be thoughtful and more intentional about that. So are any of us that would be comfortable standing, we'd like to welcome. Also, this afternoon, there'll be the service for Carrie Boyd this afternoon that will be at Spring Branch Presbyterian Church. We value your prayers for his family and for Reverend Kevin Boyd and his family, friends, those who can be a part and go and support. You are very encouraged, but we all want to be lifting up prayers for the family. Now, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Good morning, and join me in the call to worship. You live in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty.
We will say to the Lord,
my refuge, and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Because you have made the Lord your dwelling place, no evil shall befall you.
God will protect those who call on the name of the Lord and show them salvation.
Join me in the prayer. Together, we call upon you, O God. Hear our prayer. We raise our voices in glad adoration. You have brought your people out of bondage. You ministered to Jesus when he was tempted by Satan. You know when your people are afflicted and understand their entrenchment when they are alone and dismayed. We pause along the journey to bow down before you and worship your name. Amen. Please be seated. Call to confession. Our choices of self-driven lifestyles struggle with the daily temptations of putting ourselves first over the daily needs before us and the opportunities to serve those God brings across our path. A prayer of confession. Together, O Judge and Redeemer, we come before you, shorn of all pretenses and without cause of pride. We care more about the bread and the confession of Christ's Savior. We worship many gods and do not serve you alone. We offer bribes to gain up your favor. We do not rally in your promised goodwill. Forgive our deceit and grant us forgiveness. Through Christ we repent sinful ways. Amen. Assurance of pardon. Paul writes, if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. John writes, if we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's from 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. Friends, in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Seated. It is now time for our young disciples' message. If any young at heart, as well as any of the children that are with us, want to come forward, you might have one or two, but I think many have gone back already. Come sit with. We also appreciate. Hi there. Do you want to come and sit with me right here? Mr. Bernard will help you. I was going to say we have a few already back with Katrina and a few here. We are so glad that you're here today, and I appreciate Young at Heart getting right beside you. I want us to remember that God reminds us that through God's love and through trusting God, we can talk about things that we might struggle with. The scriptures call it temptation. It's a big word, but you know what? Is there things that you like that you, like your parents say, you gotta wait till dinner? Are there any snacks that you like sometimes that you ask for? Anything that maybe is sweet or salty? Like, what's your thought? Anything that you like to eat maybe before dinner that you sometimes your mom or dad says no, or your grandma? Any idea? Anything? What is it? Cookies? Cookies are good. Mine is ice cream. I have to confess. In the afternoon, that ice cream sweet sounds so good. And we know that that's kind of called a temptation because we should wait to have our good meal first, right? When we hear the scriptures, it tells us that anything that we struggle with, God will help us. And that temptation, Christ has conquered. I just want you to remember, we talk to our Lord and say, help us not eat things we shouldn't eat. Sometimes it's a lot bigger, but God loves us and is with us. Will you pray with me? Let's pray together and pray after me. Thank you, God, that you love us and that you give us strength to say no to those things that harm us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for sitting with me. You did great. Thank you, Young at Heart, sitting with.
Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, prepare our hearts and minds to hear and receive your word for our lives today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Our first scripture reading this morning comes from Psalm 91, verse 1 through 2 and 9 through 16. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. If you say the Lord is my refuge and you make the Most High your dwelling, no harm will overtake you. No disaster will come near your tent. For he will command his angels concerning you to guide you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread in the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. because he loves you. Says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call on me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Here ends the reading of his word.
Our second scripture reading is taken from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4, verses 1 through 13. This passage speaks to the power of temptation and to the ways in which Christ conquers all. Christ is the power in which we address those things in our lives that are leading us in ways God is not. Hear the word of the Lord. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the desert, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them, he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man does not live on bread alone." The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, "I will give you all their authority and splendor, for it has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. So if you worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered, "It says, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. Friends, this is the word of the Lord for our daily living. We enter into a very important season for us as disciples. I don't think some of us maybe come with traditions in Lent, but some of us might. We might have families that very much have ways in which Lent is marked. With Ash Wednesday, those of us who had opportunity to participate and to receive the imposition of the ashes, the palms that were used to wave and praise Christ and praise God, the sense of anticipation of finally the Messiah is here. Those palms are burned, reminding us a year later of the ways in which Christ went from a place of those seeking to the place in which we know the days ahead, the preparation for laying his life down. Lent is a time in which we introspectively enter into a pondering, a sense of centering, that we who follow, we who know and claim Christ as our Lord, are called to go inward and to look at our relationship and the ways that we dwell with God daily, the ways that we experience God's love and grace and sustaining presence are the ways in which we struggle. You see, Lent is a time that is intentional reflection, intentional ways that we make time to understand what Christ was preparing, to lay his life down for all, that all might have life in and through the sacrifice he gives, in which the Godhead proclaims, forever sin is dead, forever life is new, forever death does not have the final say. See, our salvation we celebrate is based upon the ways in which Christ decidedly moved in a direction, being fully God, fully human, sacrifices out of the depth of love we cannot even begin to comprehend, that we might be given life, that we might be emancipated, that we might be renewed, that we might be children of God, no longer born of the broken flesh, no longer having sin that claims us. We come to a passage this morning that I think from the Gospel of Luke chapter 4 is so important for us to understand what's happening here in this well-known description of Christ being tempted by the enemy and the ways in which, being fully human, he had choices, just as we have choices, of how we handle our needs and our wants, how we trust or how we take it into our own hands and deliberate and make things happen, even in the name of God, that is not of God's timing, that is not of God's centered peace, that is not of the essence of where Christ is leading us. Many say this passage from in verses 1 through 13, as it describes a movement of how the enemy tests our Lord, it's a sense of reflection of how we are tested too in our daily living. Have you ever heard that parallel before? It's a powerful truth that begins with the sense of the times we live in. We have to be honest. We are surrounded daily in a culture that says, get it while you can. It is the mentality that if you cut corners and you are quick to the draw and you have ways in which you can justify how you do it your own way, because the ends are what really counts, not the means. This is the ways in which Christ is tempted. We know that this is a symbolic experience of Christ declaring the very nature of being fully God, fully human, and that Christ overcomes as we can overcome. But we need to understand what our context is here. It's one in which Jesus is tempted in the wilderness. Those 40 days, as we see and we know, are so important because the 40 days is a sense of journeying to completion. Have you ever heard that the numbers 40, 7, and 12 in the Hebrew language and in the Jewish tradition is a sense of completion, fulfillment? So the 40 days are symbolic that as Christ is out in the wilderness and as he is with need, he does not choose to cut corners. He does not choose to give in, knowing that he is called and that he has a choice. And he sees the long view. He sees the focus of eternity and why he is here. And he is sustained. Now, we need to look closely at the ways in which this temptation unfolds. But first, we have to be honest with, do we understand the term temptation? Today, as I talked about, just things that we desire, things that we like, but we may not always choose them in ways that help us. You know, like that great sense of chocolate sundae at the end of a week that might be tempting us when we've taken time to be very good with our diet, and be it our health or be it just wanting to have better disciplines, eat well, and there's that sense of tempting dessert. Some of us may not have a sweet tooth. It might be the temptation of taking a break. And we know that breaks are good, but are we taking the break and time off to avoid, to be able to care for others? Timing of when we take our breaks, we get honest. Also, the term tempting, if we look at carefully, is one in which desire, interest, enjoyment, the positives, it does not possess a negative outcome, but it's what we do with it. And we see that the basic outline of temptation here, you could argue, is short-term urges for enjoyment that threatens long-term goals. Have you ever heard that definition for temptation? That's kind of our human understanding. We need to have disciplines. We need to direct ourselves in ways that care for ourselves and that don't allow ways in which short-term enjoyment takes over and becomes forms of avoidance, forms of, unfortunately, harm, forms in which it becomes all-consuming. Temptation also describes the coaxing or inducing of a person into committing such an act by manipulation or curiosity, desire or fear of loss. In the context of self-control and ego depletion, temptation is described as an immediate and pleasurable urge, an impulse that disrupts an individual's ability to wait for the long-term goals. What a mouthful. Temptation has, my friends, layers. When we say, oh, that's such a tempting offer, that's such a tempting idea, that's such a temptation in which I need to say no. You see, what the context here that Christ is being faced with, the temptations are clear. One is to look to the fallen one to provide all that is needed materially. The food is symbolic. Bread is symbolic. It's the source of life. to look to not the God who has created all, but to the short-term solution of being great with hunger and turning to something that you know that is going to bring destruction. So Christ here, when he quotes back to the enemy, to the devil, what does he quote back with? Not his own authority, not the Godhead authority, but he uses the word of God. He quotes from Deuteronomy chapter 8. He quotes from Deuteronomy chapter 6 twice, and he redirects. He understands this is the solid rock in which he faces real life temptations. When we are at great need, when our hunger, our sustenance is cut off, when we don't have means to provide for our family and ourselves, friends, that is a time of temptation. That is a place in which we look and long for, and we start problem solving that may take us down a road that brings great consequences of negative impact, if not destruction, to our own self and our families. It's real in regards to sustenance and being faced. It's the depth of where Christ is faced. And he looks to the scriptures and states the truth, the living word that states life. He then is tempted in ways in which all the kingdoms will be given to him if he will worship the other, not the true God, not the triune God, not Yahweh, Elohim. But quickly, he responds with refuting the lie. See, he looks to the living word. And thirdly, the temptation of being able to display power. What do we look for power? Who is our power source? How do we get in our daily living a sense of our personhood, our worth, our sense that we matter and that we have a presence where we go, where we work, where we are for school, in our social circles, in our neighborhood, our communities? Where do we have a sense that we have a presence and power? See, that temptation Christ is given is very real in our lives, is it not? When we seek power over the good of others, when we seek power at the destruction of others, when we seek power, as we're watching internationally happen right now, friends, in Europe, in ways in which there is great injury, there is unclear a sense of how nations fight for land and prominence at the great sacrifice of human life. This human struggle is so real. And again, Christ redirects through the word of God, the living word of God, the solid rock that we are given to direct our lives upon. This is no mere act of just Christ and his method of handling temptation. This is to model to us as disciples how we face these areas of temptations in our lives. Do we have the long view? You have to ask that first question, because temptations happen when things don't work out, when we don't have our timeline, when we are tired and we are frustrated. Do we have the view, eternal view, God's calling us to? Do we have the patience of faith? Or do we short circuit? And see, when we short circuit, we know there's not long life, is there, to come. There is real consequences when we short circuit. There is a particular author and preacher, pastor, and he doesn't like being called this, but a biblical scholar graduating from Princeton University, and Eric Elness is one who has written and preached and looks at culture, the time we live in, of how we talk about our faith in Christ, how we are living in the midst of the world, and how we handle temptation, the distortions. That's another term you could use for temptations. Distortions of truth. See, distortion thinking and distortion choices bring such great injury. And why that is so important is that when we see the Word of God and the promises, we are presented with a choice. Do we trust God's Word, or do we trust the immediate solution we humanly come with? It's a powerful place in which Christ models, and Eric Elness says this in regards to the way that the church today has struggled to bring in those who are on the periphery, those who are no longer feeling connected, those who feel not heard, not addressed, not in the middle of what the needs, not in the struggles of our larger community, almost see the church isolated. Eric Elness in his study says, you know, those that are, there's terms for this, that feel displaced as Christians are those who are seekers, have this great criticism against the church. And it's surprising. He says, you know, the church so proclaims, and the message of the gospel in Jesus Christ is that you will be blessed. And in that blessing, you will be able to bypass. You will no longer suffer. You will no longer be hit with temptation. You will no longer have injury. You will no longer long and be lost. And when they've gone through their lives, they've had experiences that show and have presented them with just the opposite. And Eric Elness says, you know, the old saying, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. They don't want to have that hoodwink experience again. What is our message about once we come into union with God and once we are in communion through the power of Christ Jesus and our salvation is in and through him? Will we have periods of suffering? Will we have periods of temptation? Will we go through those losses that humanly are unbearable? We will, friends. But that does not mean God is not with us, that God is not working in and through, that God is not blessing us. See, the church falls into a lot of the message of the health and wealth gospel that was happening in the nation of Israel. And as they worshiped, there was that sense of you judged by those who appeared to be blessed. And those who were with losses and hardship and trials and tribulation, that was God's sign of God not being and dwelling with that individual. The larger church in the 21st century has really struggled with the clear message of how to be there for those who are dealing with temptations, those believers who are dealing with losses, those believers who are in the midst of real struggle. Why is that important? Because I feel like we need to hear today that the message from our passage this morning as disciples of Christ is we need to understand how to move through temptation. We need to understand how to be there for one another in our temptations. We need to know how, as a church, to profess the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ, to conquer temptation and loss and hardship, and that there is life to come upon the cross. Christ gave us life, right? But if we don't walk alongside others, if we as believers are only affiliating with success, only affiliating with those who are of power, only choosing those means that give us gain at the loss and hard loss of others, we're not about justice. We're not about mercy. We're not seeking God's truth, are we? We have to look at our lives in this time of Lent to do a deep reflection. This is not just a liturgical calendar event of the year where we have seasons of the church year to remind us. This is opportunity to go deeper, to become disciples who are grounded, who go through temptation and experience the ministering of the loving God with you. And you remember the psalm that we read this morning from Psalm 91? It is a powerful declaration, is it not? God is our refuge. God is our fortress. This is written by a psalmist under great hardship, not of what we would evaluate as successful and of means and of clear signs of power and presence and moving. No, it's written in a time of great loss and struggle and tribulation. But God will be with us. God will bless us. God will sustain us. We will move through and we will be healed and we will be fortified. And the psalm promises something even greater. We are God's. The Lord God has precious given of a life that is a life we could never, when we come to the table, be of means, earning, of merit, or any other form that we have humanly that could substitute. It is a sacrifice that is most precious and holy. It is through the very act of love that Christ displays on the cross and suffers for our sin, for our separation, for the ways in which we can live in darkness, that we are emancipated and we're invited to come to the table. We are invited as we start Advent, Lent, and go through this season to look inward and trust the journey, whatever we need to face to grow closer to God, and to trust God has the power to heal, and that God speaks to us about where we're to go with our gifts and our timing and our decisions and the things that weigh on our hearts as leaders of the church, and the ways in which each of us here come with our own personal journeys and questions. Our living, loving God, Lord Jesus, is with us, calling us to a deeper union. So make this Lent time to go into a deeper communion with the Lord. Allow the Holy Spirit to minister and support you and to comfort you in those areas. This is a time to receive, and this is a time to recommit. The beauty of fasting in the early church is one in which I feel that we in our contemporary times don't appreciate. I know some of you for Lent may say, I'm going to not have this certain food, or I'm going to sacrifice this certain habit so I can have more time to focus upon my relationship with God. I don't know if some of you come from traditions where Lent is a time that we struggle to keep those commitments, but we make space and time. Fasting is another tool where we potentially weekly look for ways to not eat and have a sense of focus and dedicate that time to go inward, to reflect upon God's word, to be in prayer, to allow the Spirit to teach us, nurture us, be sustained, not through only food and the material world, but by the spiritual world, that we are destined, that we are a part of the eternity. We are moving with a long term perspective. Friends, our call this Lent is to trust that Jesus is calling us to that long-term perspective, growing in our faith, and taking that love and that experience out to others who are in need. There will be so many opportunities in these weeks ahead before Easter. May we, as we commune at the table this morning, experience God's special blessing in our lives in this Lenten season, as we look inward and trust the leading of our Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. Let us pray together. We thank you, gracious God, that we are your children. Oh, Lord Jesus, we come before you and pray that you will awaken us as we enter into this Lenten season, that we would make more time as your disciples to seek you and to receive from your communion through the Holy Spirit, to be ministered to, that we might minister to others. Help us, O Lord, to bring before you all that is internally never possibly shared, but that you so see. May we trust your grace, mercy, love to conquer all, for you are our refuge, you are our fortress. In Christ Jesus we pray, amen. I am blessed by the fact that health is a gift, and I'm grateful to be back and feeling better. And I pray that as we all gather in our sense of thoughts as we begin Lent, that we would look for the ways that we give and express what we've been given. Let us give, understanding God works in and through the gifts that we give, declaring God's love, mercy, truth, and the power of our Lord that is at work in our lives and in the lives that are touched by your giving. Let us give our tithes and gifts at this time. Be seated. And we will begin our gathering and celebration of the communion table, inviting us each to be a part of the whole. Christ reminds the disciples, as there is one loaf, so we are one body. As there is one cup that we drink forth from, we are one in the Spirit and in the union and power of the Holy Spirit. And we gather as we start Lent to remember the days ahead, the walk to the cross, the tremendous sacrifice that has given us each life anew in Christ Jesus. Friends, this salvation, this life that is not every day that binds us, unites us. This salvific relationship is the precious gift that we come to receive and ponder as we have a simple celebration and a meal together today. Let us bring our burdens, our struggles, our questions, the ways in which we each here might be battling, the temptations in our lives. Our Lord has the power to overcome. Our life in Christ gives us anchoring. And as we eat of the bread and drink of the cup, we are renewed. Let us trust these words together. The Lord be with you.
And also
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Let us pray together. It is truly right and our greatest joy to give thanks and praise to you, Almighty God. We are given such power and such opportunity daily to unite with you, to remember that as we come to partake of this meal together, that you have blessed us, that you have given us life, and you have raised up your leaders, and you have promised through your covenant of old for there to be eternal life in the Messiah, your Son. And as Christ so declares in the scriptures today, he found power in the living word to refute any temptation, any struggle. Gracious God, we remember the prophets of old declaring your union, your declaration of your mercy that can overcome all sin. Through the prophets of old and through Abraham, the covenant of grace to be a light unto the nations, you bring forth today your full covenant, the new covenant in Christ Jesus. For we have had the blessing of the declaration and the teachings of old and the fulfillment of your promises and Christ coming into this world, living his life, calling out those friends, disciples to follow. And so we are invited to follow. Gracious God, may each of us hear and be reminded that we as the disciples of Christ are given a precious gift, a gift of renewal, a gift in which we are given each opportunity now to reflect upon and to know that through your Spirit and through us trusting Christ Jesus, we are given renewal and we are given cleansing and we bring all that separates us and lay it before you. And through your miraculous power and unity in the triune God, you allow us to know the cleansing, the renewal, the healing that Jesus Christ gave the most precious gift that we might have this, his own life. And he has overcome all sin. He has overcome all separation. He has overcome all temptations. So we look to him and we come before you and ask you to prepare ourselves as we ponder the last time that he gathered with his disciples. And in preparing them, he reminded them of the bread as he gave thanks and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body." And as he also came and lifted the cup in the same way, saying, "This cup is the cup of the New Testament, shed for the forgiveness of sins, sealed in my blood." Gracious Lord, let us too come to you and trust these words in the scriptures that declare this union, this covenant that we have with you. And as your disciples, gracious God, we lift up to you now the needs of the world that we live in. You know the struggles. You know the depth of ways in which in these 2 years of the pandemic, of the many strifes, the many ways in which our nation has been in an internal reflection and ways to uphold and bring forth greater forms of unity, greater forms of equity, greater forms, gracious God, through you that bring justice, that bring your living word into this world that brings radical change and healing. Help us, gracious God, to be those disciples who are truly building bridges of cultures in Christ, bringing a message of hope and salvation and of life that empowers and that changes. And even in the midst of great strife internationally, as we pray for Ukraine, as we pray for the leadership internationally, and we pray for peace, we don't say that with just intellectual assent. We say that from our hearts, that all, gracious God, that is within this world, we would be those who are truly trusting your word, being peacemakers, being radical servants in your name, and allowing ourselves to trust this Lenten season for renewal and healing in our own personal lives. We think of our family in St. Paul and those who can't join us in worship but are with us virtually. We pray for those members. We pray for their needs and their physical and emotional, spiritual burdens. We pray for each other as we are here now, as we prepare to come to this table and partake of the sacrament. Gracious God, may you enter into our time of partaking of this powerful, simple meal that becomes an extraordinary, uniting meal in Christ Jesus as we pray together, as Christ taught his disciples, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On the night of our Lord's arrest, he took the bread, giving thanks, and he broke it amongst his dear friends, the disciples, saying, This is my body, broken for you. Take, eat, do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup and he said, This cup is the new covenant. Friends, the new covenant that is sealed in my blood, shed for forgiveness of sins. Take, drink, do this in remembrance of me. As often as we eat of the bread and drink of the cup, we celebrate our Lord's soon coming return, and let us enjoy the feast for the people of God. Let us pray together. Thank you, gracious Lord, for the ways that you bring us together in and through your powerful love, a love that transforms, a love that renews us when we are burdened and we are without hope, a love that instills in us a sense of seeking you as our refuge. Truly understanding you are building a fortress of life in our lives that will be a blessing unto us and unto others. Gracious God, we are grateful for this meal. We are grateful for the sacrifice that you have made for us upon the cross. And as we believe and receive your message, we are cleansed. We are new creations in Christ Jesus. So we pray that we can be united and go forth, renewed, strengthened, and with hope in a hurting world, in a world of conflict, in a world that truly, gracious God, you are at work and you use your people as instruments of peace. May we be so as we leave this time of worship, for we lift this up in the name, the most powerful name, the conquering name, the name that we call our Lord. Christ Jesus, amen.
Thank you.
Let us go forth with these words and trust that God will work in and through you and give you the power to face any temptation that is in your life. So hear the words. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord give you favor and peace. Amen.
Give you peace, the Lord.